So it's been exactly 68 hours since I ran on Sunday. Pulled up great. The quad is feeling awesome since that little setback. The plan today is to run 12 by 30 meters. But what I really want to do today is tackle one of the most important sports science concepts there is. Supercompensation. The concept of supercompensation is pretty basic, but it underpins every decision we make as a coach. Now we have time going this way, and we have a training stressor at point zero. After we train, we initially have a dip where we are worse off than we were before we started. From there, if you give the body time to rest and regenerate, it returns up back to baseline. It starts to compensate for the effects of the training stimulus or the training stress. From there, if you allow enough time, your body will actually supercompensate and it'll go over where it was before. That over-adaptation is our body basically preparing itself for the next onslaught of training or stimulus. Now, if you apply another stress too early and apply it down here, when you're at the lowest point in that reactive phase, you can effectively dig a deeper hole. If you dig enough of these deep holes in a row, in a row, in a row, you'll eventually overtrain and burn the body out. What we want to do long-term is these constant, smooth, upward moving graphs, where eventually, if you zoom out on it, it's going to look like this nice, long, slow, gradual progression, which is the whole point of training in sports. So that's the basic concept of supercompensation. But from here, things get a little bit tricky. Typically, muscles work on a 48-hour cycle. Tendons and ligaments are closer to a 72-hour cycle. Bone, which is actually a dynamic adaptive tissue, that's closer to a 96-hour adaptation cycle. And then the nervous system is completely random. It depends entirely on the type of training, the type of recovery you're doing, and also on the other stresses you've got going on in your life. And to make matters just a little bit more complex, different modes or different types of training will affect different parts of your body at different rates. Lifting for strength is most taxing on the neural and the muscular systems. Lifting for hypertrophy is more about the muscular system. While sprinting in the early days is quite taxing on the muscles and tendons, but once you've built up a tolerance to the volume in your training program, it ends up being more stressful on the nervous system and on the bones. So what does this all mean for you? For the average trainee, just trying to stay ready for the zombie apocalypse, keeping 48 to 72 hours between the same type or intensity of training stimulus is the best way to keep your bones, your tendons, and your neuromuscular system as fresh and healthy as possible. So a run on a Monday, lifting on a Tuesday, and then some non-weight-bearing cardio on a Wednesday, for example, is a really good option. For someone like me, coming off an injury or a surgery or any time out of sport, I need to be particularly careful when it comes to my tendons and bones. So for me, all my ground reaction force work is at least 72, sometimes 96 hours apart. So I'm only running twice a week, on a Wednesday and a Sunday, and then I'm jumping maybe once a week. This week I didn't even jump, but sometimes I'm jumping on a Monday, sometimes doing a light bit of agility on a Thursday. And then if you're an athlete, it's all about maintaining your volume. If you're training hard and training consistently and pulling up fresh, recovering well and got no problems, then keep it up. Having fluctuations in your training volume is one of the biggest factors when it comes to injuries. Being old, having a history of previous injury, and then a fluctuating training volume where you have lots of spikes and lots of troughs in your volume is a big factor when it comes to your injuries. So keep it steady, keep that floor and keep that ceiling on your volume and your intensities, and you're gonna go fine.
Good line.
Damn.